So we have been learning to understand the theory of deformation texture evolution with the help of viscoplastic self-consistent model, right? Crystal plasticity, right? So I thought that we should also don't forget the metallurgist point of view, the theory of deformation texture, right? So you see, okay, this is a theory of deformation texture evolution, a metallurgist point of view. I start with very basic that you know that a deformation in a normal material like a steel or an aluminium, copper or any other structural material which are basically face centered cubic or body centered cubic, right? Few of them, titanium, magnesium, are hexagonal close packed. And in case of face centered cubic and body centered cubic, say the face centered cubic, the slip system is mainly 111 plane, 110 direction, right? So if the stacking fault energy is high, then even if the 110 direction splits into 112 partial dislocations, then also these two partial dislocations are not very far apart, and therefore the cross slip of screw dislocations are possible and the climb of the edge dislocation, maybe a heat assisted one, could be very easily available. However, if the stacking fault energy is low, for example materials like brass or alloyed aluminium alloys or copper based alloys, in that case what will happen, when the slip system is restricted, when the cross slip is restricted, then the twin system, that is the 111, 112 type of K and eta 1 kind of twins become active, right? So you see, the variation of stacking fault energy will lead to the variation in the deformation mechanism in terms of slip and twin activities, leading to formation of a different texture, and therefore we know that we have a copper type texture and a brass type texture, right? In case of body centered cubic also, there is a pencil glide, and we know that, and we know that the closest packed direction is always 111, and depending upon the deformation temperature we have various slip planes. At lower temperature it is 110, at higher we have 112, sometimes 123 becomes active, and therefore the possibility of slip based deformation in case of body centered cubic material is very high. We know that even though the body centered cubic material is not as closest packed as the face centered cubic or the hexagonal close packed, right? But yes, there are so many slip systems, sometimes twin occurs, 112, 111. Usually most of the body centered cubic materials are considered to be having a high stacking fault energy. For example, ferritic steels. If we take the most normal one, interstitial free steel, is considered to be having a very, very high stacking fault energy. The possibility of formation of any kind of twins, higher order twins, like formation of CSL boundaries, are almost absent in this case. There are very few reports in the literature which shows that there are very minute, extremely negligible formation of such kind of CSL boundaries, right? Yes, I have not shown the hexagonal close packed material, but we have seen it in the last slide that there are basal, prismatic, pyramidal shapes, and maybe not at all temperature these all slip systems are active, right? And therefore twin has to be active, and today we will know why, right? So let's go to the next slide. you see that whenever a deformation takes place in a single crystal, for example, let us say that this is a single crystal, and let us say that these two points are not fixed, it can move in the horizontal direction while we are pulling it in the vertical direction. Now, what will happen? That a deformation will lead to activate a certain slip plane and a slip direction, and this will be based on the Smith factor and the critical result shear stress. So, as the stress which is multiplied by the Smith factor m, which is nothing but cos alpha cross gamma, that is the angular relationship of the perpendicular to the plane with the direction of the force, or the direction and the direction of the slip with the direction of the force, that is cos alpha and cos gamma is the m, which is the Smith factor. And then once this m times the sigma, which is the stress relative to the force we are applying, becomes equal to the critical result shear stress, which is the material property, that means the result shear stress becomes equal to the critical result shear stress, the slip starts to occur, right? And once the slip starts to occur, there is a shift on the top and the bottom like this, right? And this should occur if the horizontal movement is free, right? And thereby, if you see, with the deformation there is no change in the texture, right? Because the slip is occurring. But in most of the cases what happens is that we have fixed top and bottom, and when we do a tensile test, because of the formation, because of the slip in a particular plane which has the highest Smith factor, right, which reaches the critical result shear stress much earlier, slips, there is a rotation. You see, there is a rotation. So, initially it will start like this, but when we pull it up, the plane will start to rotate, right, because it cannot move horizontally, it is fixed. So, when we are pulling it, the plane will start to rotate, because it cannot go like this. So, in order to slip, it will rotate, and that is what we see as the texture evolution during any kind of deformation, right? Simply, right? So, you see that here are the slip bands that we can see for a single crystal in such a case, and that is what I am saying, that when the planes are like that, okay, and we are compressing it, then this plane will form, when we are doing a tension, then the planes will rotate in order to maintain the slip activity. On the other hand, if the planes are like this and we are compressing, it will rotate in the other direction in order to get it aligned. See, that is why you see when we are rolling aluminium, we get 111 plane on the rolling plane, right? So, the closest pack plane becomes aligned with the rolling plane, right? So, you see, while we talk about deformation in a polycrystalline material, we say that it follows the von Mises criterion, right? A von Mises criterion says that minimum 5 independent slip systems are required to deform a polycrystalline aggregate successfully without any fracture, right? To deform it plastically properly. Now, if we see that a stress applied, say a tension is applied in a single crystal, let us take a single crystal first, and then the stress matrix remains this. If the stress is applied along sigma 1 1, the 1 1 direction, so we are applying a tensile load along 1 1 direction, and so the stress matrix remains this. And when we apply this stress, there is a strain incorporated in the material, right? And this strain is basically along the stress, right? Sigma 1 1, so epsilon 1 1, right? But on the other hand, in the y and the z direction, there will be some kind of a shrinkage, right? So, we know very well that it is related and that is minus of epsilon 11 by 2 in y direction and in z direction, right. We also know that during any kind of plastic deformation there is no change in the volume, right. So, epsilon 11 plus epsilon 22 plus epsilon 33 should be equal to 0. Now, when we talk about stress in a grain of a polycrystalline, that is applied stress, there is a grain boundary contiguity also incorporated in it, right. That is what I was saying. So, if the applied stress is this, the stress in a grain inside a polycrystalline material will be the applied stress plus the grain boundary contiguity, which should be something like this. So, stress inside a grain or inside a portion of a grain will be this. So, in the applied stress, even the other things are 0. In a polycrystalline material, when it goes to a certain grain which is surrounded by other grains, will not be 0, right. So, stress will be something like this. So, sigma 11, sigma 22, sigma 33 will be present, tau 12, tau 13, tau 21 will be present, and which will be equal because of the symmetry, right. Now, if we are having such a stress tensor which is being applied actually in the grain, then relative to that we will have the stress tensor like this. So, instead of the strength tensor remaining so simple, it will become like this, right. And as you know that epsilon 11 plus epsilon 22 is equal to epsilon 33. So, we have how many independent strains? We have epsilon 11, epsilon 22, this is 2, and then epsilon 12, epsilon 13 and epsilon 23, right. Also, epsilon 12 is equal to epsilon 21. Epsilon 13 is equal to epsilon 31 and so. So, we have totally, if you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, there are 5, minimum 5 independent strains which are required to deform a polycrystalline aggregate. So, if we need 5 independent strains in 5 independent directions, right, then with respect to each strain, minimum one slip system is required in that direction, right. With respect to each strain, a minimum slip system has to be required in that direction. So, as I said that therefore, minimum 5 independent component of strain will require minimum 5 independent slip systems, okay. That is minimum. If a certain strain could not be incorporated by a single slip system, there may be requirement of more 6 or 7 kind of slip systems. But for a successful plastic deformation of a polycrystalline aggregate, therefore, a minimum 5 independent slip systems are required, okay. And this is basically the Taylor's model that Professor Laszlo Toth is teaching you now. So, you see he has taught you many, many models, but just to show you what is the difference is that one is the Sachs model which considers Smith factor for the deformation, and in the Sachs model even if the metal is polycrystalline, it considers each grain to be separately deforming following the Smith's law and is not taking care of the grain boundary contiguity. So, it is not real, however, we know this formula, right, is the relationship of the resolved shear stress with the Smith factor and the applied stress. In case of Taylor's model, the Taylor factor is basically taken. I am not going into details of that because Professor Toth might be teaching you this for a long time. And then you see here the stress incorporated in each grain is not exactly equal to the stress applied and is equal to applied plus the grain boundary contiguity thing. And therefore, the grain boundary continuity is maintained, and that's the difference between the Taylor model, which incorporates requirement of multiple slip, that is minimum 5 independent slip systems for deformation, whereas the Sachs model, which consider slip system, says that it will deform by the highest Smith factor, the one which reaches, which slip system will reach the critical resolved shear stress earlier, the one which has a highest Smith factor. So, you see, during deformation, the volume remains the same, right? And the shape of the grains change. So, there is an increase in the grain boundary area, right? Now, the increase in, where does this increase in the grain boundary area come from? It's very, we all know that it comes from dislocation-dislocation interaction, and this dislocation are forming due to different kinds of sources, maybe a Frankfurt source, dislocation interaction with secondary phase if they are present. So, all interactions will lead to increase the dislocations, and this dislocation misorientation will increase. The misorientation will with the help of other difference in the stress tensors at different positions of the grain boundary, in the grain, will create a lattice curvature and thereby introduce geometrically necessary boundaries, and which during the deformation will increase this misorientation further to form grain boundaries, right? So, you see that while we give a deformation, we are adding stored energy. The addition of the stored energy in the material is physically in the formation of addition of more and more dislocations in the material, right? So, you see the dislocations which will form dislocation arrays or will come together to form a group, maybe incidental dislocation boundaries, that is maybe cells and subgrain formation, will maybe later, because of the formation of lattice curvature, will increase this misorientation to form LAGBs or very low angle boundaries and low angle boundaries, and thereby slowly with more strain will form high angle boundaries or grain boundaries, right? So, you see the rolling, just for an example, leads to formation of a lath kind of grains, right? Drawing extrusion will lead to form a needle kind of grain, and the compression a disc shaped grain. Basically, what I mean to say is that initially, if we consider equiaxial grain, the shape of the grain changes, the shape dictates that the area or the volume inside the grain remains the same, but the circumference of the grain, that is the grain boundary area, is increasing. Where this increased area is coming from? That's what is happening in every case, in case of rolling, in case of drawing or extrusion, or in case of compression, right? So, you see, during deformation, as I said, an internal structure is being developed inside the grain. This structure is basically the stored energy. These structures are basically dislocations and the new interfaces, that is low angle boundaries. Now, most of the deformation which creates this stored energy, this dislocation structure or dislocation boundaries, are basically only 1%. Rest of the energy is basically converted into heat, okay. So, you see, heterogeneity in the deformation within a grain is present in every case. So, the stress, this is a repetition of course, the stress acting at the center in the grain is different from that which is near to the grain boundary. The grains are never perfect and therefore contain substructure, cells, dislocation, even initially. See, so you see that even inside the grain, because of the presence of different substructures or a hierarchical structure, the orientation inside the grain was initially different. And because the grain boundary, misorientation of the grain boundary with the nearby grain is also different, so in various places the incorporated stress tensors are also different. So while during the deformation, the grain itself creates an hierarchical structure inside it, right? And this hierarchical structure with more and more deformation increases the misorientation of certain area inside the grain with the certain area, right? And let's see, I am going to show you that, okay? So you see, very simply, that the most fundamental structure which is present inside the grain is the dislocation arrays. So you have statistically stored dislocations present in the in the grains, which are very, very important to deform the material. And because of this requirement of these, means statistical requirement of the present of this dislocation, the strength of the material is quite lower in magnitude as compared to its Young modulus, modulus of elasticity. Now the thing is that these dislocations, which are present separately or in terms of arrays, have misorientation angle very, very small, very, very lower than even 1 degree. But when a slight deformation is provided to the material, this dislocation comes together, and mostly it occurs in a high stacking fault energy to form incidental dislocation boundaries or subgrain or subcells. Higher than that, and these have near 1 degree misorientation. And if there is a lattice curvature, means a difference in the stress tensors in various parts of the grain, this leads to formation of microband, and these are these. Okay? These are the cell and the subgrain structure, between under which there could be dislocation densities. These are dislocations, and these microbands basically have a misorientation difference from one microband to another microband by a 1 to 3 degrees. And you see, when we go inside the grain from one microband to another microband, you will see there is a misorientation of 1 degree somewhere, 1.4 degree somewhere, then minus 2 degree somewhere, like that. Okay? So we will go ahead. And another hierarchical microstructure little feature is deformation band. You see, the deformation bands are produced, these are the microband, if you say, okay, and above that deformation bands are produced. These deformation bands are sometimes also forms like kink band, where the orientations could be related by A, C and A, like that. Now the point is, up to the deformation bands, basically the deformation bands occurs when a deformation is occurring on microstructure with coarse grains. Mainly the grain size should be, it's not an absolute value, but mostly it is found at grain sizes more than 20 microns. Okay, and these all are features which are present inside the grain. There is another feature, that is the shear band formation, and you know that it doesn't depend on the grain size or the microstructure of the material. So the shear band forms at an angle to the rolling, say 35 degrees to the rolling direction, and it looks like this. Let's go ahead and see how the dislocations are related to the formation of subgrain and subcell structure. See, you see, the at small strains, at strains which are lower than 0.3, a material when deforms containing dislocations, cross slip, basically the screw dislocations cross slip, the edge dislocation climbs, a heat assisted climb, and this heat could be obtained from deformation, because 99% of the energy of the deformation is converted into heat. Only 1% is converted into stored energy or dislocation based energy, right? So there is heat, and then you can get a subcell or a subgrain kind of structure. You see, this is a TEM image showing 25% cold rolled copper. So I have basically described everything here. So I am going ahead. Okay, so this subgrain and subcell structures are the smallest volume element in a deformed microstructure, right? And this subcell subgrain structure divides the microstructure or the grain into regions of high dislocation density and low dislocation density, right? So the boundaries will have high dislocation densities, and between the subcell it will have a low dislocation density, right? Now the point is, when the boundary of this cell or subgrains are diffused, they are known as a cell structure. Okay, when the boundary is sharper, they are known as a subgrain structure. That's the nomenclature. Okay, these subcell or subgrain structures have misorientation less than 1 degrees or near to 1 degrees, and are basically the formation from statistically stored dislocation, and therefore are also known as incidental dislocation boundaries, IDBs, transient deformation induced boundaries, cell boundaries, and they are all statistically stored dislocations. These are all nomenclature of it. So even though I have been telling this again and again, here it is written, so I will read it out for your significance, that you see that the crystalline aggregates subjected to plastic deformation generally organize into regions of low dislocation density separated by regions of high dislocation density, which are also denoted as dislocation boundaries. A heterogeneously distribution of statistically stored dislocation subdivides the grain into cell type microstructure of approximately equiaxed and low dislocation density inside the cells, right? And separated by high density dislocation walls, and these are known as incidental dislocation boundaries. So the subcell boundaries and the subgrain boundaries are known as incidental dislocation boundaries. And this is SSDs accumulate by the statistical trapping of dislocation during the plastic slip. So this is given by Cox. And on the other hand, you see geometrically necessary boundaries or GNBs form due to different active slip systems. You see different active slip systems or different magnitudes of plastic slip among neighboring regions of an individual grain. You understood? Because the stress tensor applied are different in different regions of the grain because of maybe misorientation, grain boundary misorientation, because of the initial orientation, because of the presence of these. So you see that there are different magnitudes of slip activities in different regions, and therefore this can lead to division of the grain into cell block kind of structure. Okay, this cell block kind of structures are basically what we call it the microbands, and these GNDs are needed to preserve the lattice continuity. So you see, whenever there is a curvature in the lattice, in order to maintain that curvature continuity, there has to be formation of boundaries which are kind of very low angle or low angle boundaries, and these are known as geometrically necessary boundaries. So let's go ahead. So we have seen this, the incidental dislocation boundary, subcell and the subgrain structure, and then we go to the microband. The microband is also known as cell band or blocks. Okay, they are longer aligned boundaries, and you see it looks like this. It doesn't form all the time. You see that sometimes it is 2.8 degrees positive, minus 3.1 degree negative, so minus 1.1 degree, and this is from the TEM map of a 10% roll aluminum, and you see the how much is the strain is very small, right? So you see these are dense dislocation all, therefore also known as dense dislocation walls, DDWs, microbands, cell bands, okay, and these are all geometrically necessary dislocations because their misorientation is greater than 1 degree. So, it is, see, even one more thing is very important to understand, that these are basically capturable inside a phagasium. Okay. So, these comes under very low angle boundary status, and these occurs, these, so one band, so we have a different orientation here and a different orientation here. So, this shows that different positions of the grain have little difference in the orientation. Okay. So, you see that whenever such kind of boundaries develop inside the microstructure, what happens, because of the shape of the boundary, you see these are like straight line, during deformation it is possible that this geometry may lead to successful slip activities without even the presence of 5 independent slip system, and this is the geometric criteria because of the straight boundaries inside the grain. Okay. So, I am not going into more detail. So, okay, micro boundaries are aligned are about 25 to 40 degrees to the rolling direction. Okay. So, see, planes of high, see, these boundaries forms near the planes of high shear stress, close to 111 slip plane for an FCC metal. Let us go ahead and see what are deformation bands. So, you see, deformation bands mainly form in regions where the material is having mainly a grain size of greater than 20 micron. It can form in low stacking fault energy, it can form in high stacking fault energy, and you can see that there is a certain morphological difference between what it forms in low stacking fault and in high stacking fault. The point is that deformation bands not only forms more readily at larger coarser grain, but it also forms at lower stacking fault energy mostly, materials mostly. In case of higher stacking fault energy material, this kind of structure is most of the time we do not observe. Okay. These bands, the boundary of these bands have misorientation much higher than the micro band or the cell band structure. These boundaries, these bands have orientation, many micro bands present in it. Okay. So, you see how the hierarchical structure, there is a there are dislocations, then the cell substructure, above that there are micro bands present, lots of micro bands, and then it is covered by deformation bands, right. So, these deformation bands have a huge orientation difference, of course, the huge orientation difference is lower than the orientation difference between two grains, and you see that this is kind of, you see these are deformation bands, these are deformation bands. So, you see inhomogeneous stresses transmitted by the neighboring grains or intrinsic instability of the grain during plastic deformation leads to formation of such kind of bands, right. Deformation bands deform on, see, different slip systems and may develop widely divergent orientation. A narrow region between the deformation bands, which may be either a diffuse kind. So, you see the boundary of the deformation band may be either a diffused kind or a sharp kind, is known as a transition band. If sharp, then they are known as deformation induced grain boundary. Okay. So, the nature and the formation of the deformation banding has its relevance to the generation of the deformation texture. So, it has a huge effect on the formation of deformation texture. Okay. So, you see that when the strain is increased, when the strain is increased, and here is an example of the aluminum 0.1% of magnesium alloys, and you see that initially there were micro bands or cell band structure present, but there is almost some kind of band formation at 90 degrees to this microbands. And this forms because of the increase in the strain accumulated, and you can see that how the microstructure inside the grain is basically getting fragmented. Even though this misorientation is smaller, and you see that these bands, you see that initially there were microbands present, and then the shear band starts to form, and this is inside a grain. So these shear the elongated cell band. So these bands basically shear the elongated cell band into an S type of structure. You see S type of structure, and they have been termed as S band. Okay, and don't confuse this with the S texture, S orientation. Okay, so you see, I will suggest you that if you like, you go and read the Hurley and Humphreys book in recrystallization and related method, right? So at larger strain, what happened? The micro shear band and the cell band become more closely aligned to the rolling plane. See, if this is a rolling plane. Then initially the micro shear bands were forming at around 25 degrees to 45 degrees, right, like this. Later, if the micro shear bands are forming in this direction, the shear bands were coming perpendicular to that to break it or to form an S kind of band structure. And when the strain has increased, then all these micro shear bands and the shear bands become parallel and they become more diffused. Okay, most of the time it is very difficult to observe this in the microstructure, it is not possible to observe this. So at a strain of 2, the various bands cannot be clearly identified. You see, at this stage the micro shear band walls become high angle boundaries. So you see, as the strain is increasing, the increase in the misorientation of the micro shear band occurs. Not only the orientation is changing, not only the shape, the angular relation of the boundaries with respect to the rolling plane is changing, but also its misorientation is changing. And this is because of the interaction of these boundaries, these are small boundaries, with the dislocations, right, newly formed dislocations or the existing dislocation, right, and thereby the rolled microstructure consist of almost entirely of long lamellar boundaries. Many of them are high angle boundaries aligned parallel to the rolling plane, right. The last one is the formation of shear band. And the shear band, which I said does not depend upon the grain size or the microstructure and forms throughout the microstructure, right, forms at very high strains, very high rolling reduction. You see, in case of high stacking fault energy copper, this kind of shear bands could be observed, right, these are all shear bands. And in case of low stacking fault energy, aluminum, zinc, magnesium alloys, you can see the shear bands look slightly different. In both the cases, you will find out the shear band basically forms at around 35 to 40 degrees of the rolling direction, right. But at the same time, you will see that the shear band basically possesses a stress which is about 4 times or 5 times higher than which is present in the homogeneously inside the material. So it possesses a higher stress. So these are stress intensified areas. In some cases it is 6 to 10 times, and as I said, this is independent of grain structure and even independent of any kind of crystallographic orientation. In case of low stacking fault energy material, you will see that the dislocation cell structure could not form. You know, as the low stacking fault energy material has don't have the ability for a cross slip of true dislocation, right, because the dislocation, partial dislocations are very far apart, right. Even the climb of the edge dislocation is restricted in many cases. Mostly it starts to form twins. you see the microstructure basically looks like dislocate. See, the dislocations associate dissociate to form planar arrays of stacking faults in the slip planes. You will see like this planar arrays of stacking faults in the slip plane. And you see, you will also observe strain marking, and this is these markings. Okay, these strain markings are very fine deformation twins, and this is the example in case of 7030 brass for a 14% compression when we are observing the 111 planes. Deformation twins, see, mainly see a low stacking fault energy basically deforms initially by slip, and you will see an FCC material like brass therefore forms a copper kind of texture also. Okay, but at the same time it is restricted because of the formation of partial dislocation which could not cross slip or which could not climb, and thereby twin base deformation starts to accumulate. And this is the example of twin base deformation. And once this twin base deformation starts to accumulate, you know, brass type of texture starts to develop. On the other hand, the microstructure starts to see it, the microstructure is restricted to recover, right. So, it starts to dynamically recrystallize if at certain position the stress concentrations becomes very high, particularly the triple junctions. And because, you know, during the deformation, most of the deformation energy which we are provided is converting into heat. Therefore, discontinuous dynamic recrystallization starts to occur, leading to formation of other kind of orientation, sometimes a cube orientation. There are Gauss and S orientation also forms. Okay. So, that is it.